Gamers on Games is sponsored in part by...
Hi, this is Dennis with 3D Game Gear. We are gamers with a family-run business that specializes in 3D printed accessories for board games. We offer a wide range of items, including tokens, token cups, token boxes, player dashboards, and much more. We are always adding new items to enhance your gaming experience, so come check us out at the address below.
So you have to figure out how to make those things in numbers and then track those numbers over time so that you also have to do it kind of on a regular basis. So like that's the trade-off with like the super weird abstract like out there, like how many people did we bring joy into their lives? Okay, well we know we sold 500 copies and only 3 are like up for trade on BGG. Okay, well, that's pretty good numbers. You know, that, like, you could do that. You get to decide, right? But you can sort of track that over time to sort of see how you're progressing. And, you know, because you get to define what your goal state is and continue redefining your goal state to make sure it's reflective of both what you're trying to accomplish and what kind of environment and surrounding you're in, right? Like, if your goal is to bring joy to 5 people and you grow to a 50-person company that's putting out 7 games a year, if your goal is to bring joy to 5 people, you have left your goal, like, way in the dust, and you need to redefine what a new version of success is. So, like, these things are going to change, they necessarily change, because that's how this works, right? Like, if, you know, and for, like, this even works as, like, a single person who, tries to put out a game a year, right? Like, things will necessarily change. You get better at the game, at making games. You, over time, grow an audience. Maybe like you can track how big your personal mailing list is. You can track figures on crowdfunding campaigns, how many backers versus how many the year before versus the year before.
Yeah, to add something on that, one of the things I think is neglected in Kickstarter people, this is purely my opinion, I haven't had like a, well, not that anyone other than John Lucas had a 7C Kickstarter experience, but you know, a lot of people track their Kickstarter success by dollars, which is cool because that's how you pay things. But there is
that's a problematic number.
Yeah, exactly. But there is a very, I don't think there's enough attention paid. I don't see enough people do goals really to how many backers you get.
Absolutely.
Because if you have 500 people interested in backing you, even if it's not as much money as somebody that did 120,
if they get a product, you get a dollar each.
Yeah, I'm just saying, your product probably wouldn't cost as much, but it doesn't mean you're less successful.
That's not even necessarily true either, which is the other tricky thing, right? Like, that dollars raised does not translate to profitability, does not translate to interest. Like, if one person drops $10,000 on a project, and that's all you get,
right.
You've got one person.
Yeah, the number of backers is an audience that you can speak to the next time you want to do something.
Absolutely. Here's the other tricky thing with number of backers. That number is usually low if you have offered multiple part products right? Like, I'm offering three products for the same shipping cost, split the shipping cost to, like, one of the things that I've been doing is with, like, decks of cards, like, buy six and I'll ship them wherever for free. And I get a lot of shipments to Europe for that because it's an awesome deal for them. And there are five people now who are not accounted on that list. Like, I can kind of make some estimations about that because I know how many have been shipped. But like, that number that's really easy to read is low in that case, sure. Which it's an interesting thing, right?
Well, that's knowing your data. You mentioned your day job, mm-hmm. which from the sound of it, you like project management.
I run my company's IT department, but okay. I'm involved in the operations end of things. So
how much of the, I mean, you talk about KPIs, but how much of things like SMART goals or measurable goals or action plans do you actually work into your own project building?
So my project billing is, or my projects are explicitly about supporting the people who are billable, right? So my goals are to minimize downtime.
All right, I'm sorry. I mean, how much of that do you take from your day job? Do you take into your game design?
Oh, into the game
design. How much of the SMART goal, action plan, etc., do you bring?
I learned so much at my job. And it's super valuable because it offers me new ways to think about how I run a business. Because, like, you can run a business and be like, I'm running a business and I don't know what I'm doing and there are some dollars around and whatever. And that's still a legitimate business. Or you can, track your budgets and track your spreadsheets and have no idea what any of that data means, and that's also a functional, if it's dysfunctional, but it's a legitimate way businesses are run. Like, there are a lot of those out there. Or you can be smart about, like, figuring out what data means and where projects are not really living up to what you'd hoped. Like, my game Omega Zone does not do as well as I'd hoped, right? Like, it's kind of selling, but it's not really bringing back the kind of revenue I'd like to see, but it's still out there, so I kind of still have to have some support for it, and I've still got some inventory around, which means that I have to deal with that. And if I'm paying attention, I can make decisions about that, right? Do I pulp this and get rid of that cost and, not worry about it? Do I do a big second edition? Are the sales and apparent interest strong enough? Like, if I'm paying attention to my information and deciding where I want a thing to be, right? Like, that's basically just playing a Euro game, but like with real money and real products. And real impact on your own life, right?
Europeans do that all the time.
Europeans do that all the time. Americans do that all the time too.
Yeah.
Some better than others, right? But like, my success in Power Grid is also not directly going to translate over. But I think that there are things that we can learn from, certainly like heavier economic games and translate them into like how businesses are run, like. With the how do you win at this, except that when you translate it back, you get to decide what winning is. And it's worth setting your goals out far enough and making hard decisions about where to pull back, where to push on to win. I think that, like, I end up reading a whole lot of business books. Like, I had a job as a management consultant for a year, which I hated the job, but I really liked the information that I learned out of it. Like, running the business strategy, and those kinds of things. And a lot of it comes down to knowing what you're dealing with and setting goals that are achievable so that you can move towards them and you're not like, oh my God, how am I ever going to make $100,000 on my game stuff? Versus like, well, let's have 3 advertising campaigns and that's the goal, right? Because that doesn't help you out. You don't have, there's like your win state is spend a bunch of money, right? So a lot of it is trying to figure out the kinds of goals that will help you advance your business and then going after them and keeping them, you know, within, like ambitious, but within range, right? And games do a really good job of that. And so I think that there's a lot that we can just translate up and down in between those. Like the details are different, but the kind of impact is similar. I always feel a little bit rambly when I go on a big long tear about that. So I'm hoping I answered your question.
No, it's fine. Yeah. I run a significantly sized sales department.
Mm-hmm.
For work, like a 11 state territory.
Yeah.
So I was just wondering how much, and I try to bring a lot of it over when I work on this stuff, but how much is involved in the idea, you know, and for those of us who don't speak corporate speak, you know, SMART goals, specific, okay, right. So you want to make sure that they're, you know, attainable and all that sort of stuff. And I didn't know how much of that planning you brought in, you know, how much.
You know, I've been learning over
any black belt, you know, you bring that stuff into it.
I've been learning over time, and I bring in pieces that I think are interesting and that appeal to me. And a lot of that is around trying to translate project management as a business structure into like, well, it's me, how do I do this, right? Because that is honestly, like, for my money, the hardest thing. Like taking a framework that is designed for a team of 10 and applying it to one person. That's super hard.
And it's still about just breaking it into discrete.
It's still about doing that, but you're doing it all yourself,
yeah.
Which makes it really, not desirable, but like, it makes it like a kind of a trap, right? Because you're like, oh, well, I'm doing it all, so I don't actually have to break it down. Except that that's a terrible plan, and you still have to do that, right?
So what about if you're working, you know, this is something that I'm kind of encountering, like using ideas like SMART goals with artists who have no concept of what that means whatsoever, like
mm-hmm.
translating that so that the whole team is looking at success in the same way.
Sure.
Like, what's your experience?
I think a lot of that is about talking,
yeah.
and just general communication, and then also making sure that you understand the way to translate that. Deadlines are super easy, right? Like, how long does it take you? How long do you think it will take to draw these 4 images? 6 months? Okay, that doesn't work for me. Let's say 15 days for each, 2 months. And help break it down, right? And like you can negotiate on the time in that, like these are arbitrary numbers, but you know, in a lot of cases when running the business, it helps when you have like the full understanding of sort of like what the frameworks you are that you're putting around these different elements of things. And you don't actually have to explain all of those to everybody involved, as long as they are working, as long as they know what they have to do within that. Like if you can get them into a place where they are a black box that says, I take instruction here and I spit out, you know, piece of art at this point in time by this deadline, it's still fine and it still fits into that overall structure. And it doesn't matter whether they know what Agile is, right, for example.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter if they know how they're affecting your KPIs. It matters that they are hitting their deadlines, and you know, strictly that's all they need to know. Like, but you know, communication is kind of the key to that, making sure that they know where they fit in and how they fit into that thing, right? Like you were saying, like running sales, if I, as a salesperson, know that it is my job to hit 10 closes within the next month, that's all that matters, right? Like, here's my box to take, you know, my paycheck and spit out 10 closings. Done. Right? How that affects different things and how that is tracked is maybe interesting to me, but it's not necessarily relevant.
Secondary.
Yeah, it's super secondary. Make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, what I thought early on was the biggest challenge was when you're, you know, managing a project, and managing a whole lot of projects, but you know, when you're managing a project, you have people accountable to you, and you're accountable to somebody, right, when you're working in here. And the biggest challenge I had when we were putting together our projects was, I was the person doing the components, and I was accountable to me, right? And the biggest challenge there is there's no one keeping you on target. You have to do it.
Right.
And, you know, especially when you're doing it as a sideline, you know, I'm dead job-wise.
Yep.
It's not gonna pay your mortgage.
It's hard. Yeah.
Not the first one.
Right? Like if your goal is pay your mortgage with that, you have ambitious goals and you have to be on it. And you have to, like, there's a lot of hustle in that.
But whereas my day job's gonna pay my mortgage. So if I'm tired from my day job.
Yeah, maybe I don't do anything about the games that night.
Yeah.
That happens, absolutely. But it does not advance any of your internal goals, and it doesn't advance any of your external goals or progress towards those goals. And if you have those goals, you know that. And that becomes really clear and explicit, right? Like, if I know my goal is to sell, you know, $10,000 of product by the end of the year, I now have one less day, right? With no progress. And you can make that choice. It's fine. It's legitimate.
Self-management.
Yeah. A lot of it, I think a lot of it comes down to understanding that your choices around yourself really matter. Like when you're doing things on your own, and that they, because that's not always obvious, right? Like, you know, there's a lot of time in life that we spend not really understanding our choices and how they impact us. You know, my choice of degree program, like what that translated into was, I was really interested in this at the time, but what it does for my job prospects in New York City is almost nothing, except that I have a degree and, you know, that's it. Right? And then people say, huh, what's food science? I'm like, I have a degree in winemaking. How does that help me get an IT job? Guess what? It doesn't really, except that I maybe got past the, you know, the first, like, check, let's throw these resumes out because they don't matter, right? I don't have different things, but that's okay. Now I'm rambling again.
How do you define being an expert in two-player games?
How do I define that? I think my current definition of that is when I know that somebody else I respect within the game industry points me out as a person to reference. And, you know, it's small enough that you hear about these things. And I don't think I'm there yet, but when I figured that will happen at some point because it's something I've been working towards and I've been trying to put myself into the position of Tim knows a lot about two player games, right? I've published two of them and I try and talk about them. And I want to say, like, here is an example of step towards my goal. Here's a thing that I'm doing. I'm trying to be a known person who knows something about two player games. You know, it's there's no certificate, right? If there was, that would be really easy, right? But there's not. So I have to change what I have to make up my own marker for I have achieved that goal. I've published two of them. I've given a panel talk about them, which went off pretty successfully, and I have not gotten sort of a reference back to me that said, "Oh, Tim's an expert in two-player games. You should talk to him." So, making progress. That is kind of how I sort of picked that one.
In like academic, for instance, you get citations, right?
Sure, absolutely.
You're an expert because people are referencing
you. Because people are referencing you. And
I don't think that occurs. There's no real...
There's not a lot of like that written kind of citation, but if you hang around game people long enough, you can start recognizing influences. And I think when people recognize your influence in another game, or somebody's like, oh, I'm totally stealing that mechanic, right? Like that's a good feeling, right? When it's your mechanic. Or if people recognize your work that has then influenced somebody else, like that's a great feeling. You know, hasn't happened for me yet, but you know, it's a really cool thing to notice. Right, and that's a way you can recognize like that less explicit version of like a citation. But also at places like this, it's really easy because I can be like, oh yeah, you need somebody who's like a super economic game head. You should talk to this guy because he's a super nerd about that. And I have maybe two or three people that I point to on a regular basis if somebody is asking me a question, I'm like, I'm not the person to ask. I would ask this person. And that kind of reference, you know, people hear about. You know, if that person came to me and said, I heard you know about two-player games, I'm like, win. I now have to change my goals because I made that one.
About measuring something like impact, are there ways to measure the impact of your game? But like sales doesn't necessarily gain anything. People
right.
buy lots of games and leave them in shrink.
That's true.
Or people buy lots of games, play it once and never play again.
Mm-hmm.
What would be a way to measure impact of a game other than somebody made
right.
a new version of your game?
Honestly, the biggest way that I feel impact can be measured is in personal response. And it's one of those spaces you're like, okay, I have to take this really super abstract thing and change it into something resembling numbers so I can kind of track it over time. My game Ghost Pirates got reviewed on Ameritrash.com, which, you know, I have certain feelings about, but that is an impact. Somebody cared enough to write about it. I'm like, done, great. For me, demos are a big thing. When I demo, like I'm just showing a game, you know, and I feel that you can usually tell when people are kind of just being nice about it versus when people are really enjoying it. And, you know, when people are being nice about it, it's that half-hearted thing. Like, thanks for showing me this game. I really appreciate it. Bye. Right? Versus, oh my God, we had so much fun. Right? Like, there's a difference in reaction which you can interpret and accept and, you know, just kind of like make a chalk up a number in that win column. I think that my biggest win in terms of my game Ghost Pirates, which is a lightweight two-player tactical map-based roll fistfuls of dice at each other game, is when my friend Michael, who is a big super economic heavy game person, almost like exclusively, went, huh, and like implying that there's more going on here than he had expected. And that was honestly the biggest win that I've ever gotten with that game, right? Like, a bunch of partners can like love Ghost Pirates all day long, but like when I caught Michael being like, oh, there's a lot more here than I expected, like that really hit home and felt awesome. So it's super abstract and hard to track, but it's there if you can listen for it. A lot of that requires doing demos yourself, which is not necessarily always easy, but it's when you can, it's awesome.
It's, in my experience anyway, it's vital.
Absolutely.
Just from a pure economic point, I mean, you're talking about the success and how you feel and all that sort of stuff, but just in measuring it economically, assuming you made something people want to play, ever.
Right.
If they play it, they'll buy it. So you really have to make sure that events are being done and people are playing.
Yeah.
And conventions, especially big ones, are great for that.
It makes a big difference. With Gen Con this last year, the games that were being demoed sold so much better than games that were just there on a shelf. Like, I don't have exact numbers, but I want to say it's close to tenfold. Like, they sell so much better. Talking about games and panels, also similar kind of effect, even if they're not being demoed. If somebody, especially if somebody third party says, this is an important game and you should go play that, people are more likely to go and hit up that game. Galileo sold, I think they sold out of all the copies of Blood Red Sands they had, because somebody on a panel mentioned it, which we had no idea was going to happen, and then we were sold out of it, and we didn't expect to sell any of it. We're like, oh, we have this, it's here. Oh, and now they're gone. So that's, yeah, super great. So talking about games is, talking about other people's games is great for other people. And when we heard about that, we're like, oh my God, they talked about our game. It's great. So yeah, I think for like the biggest thing about becoming an expert is like my friend Maggie, who started in college as a medieval studies major, ended up switching to comp sci sort of halfway through, ended up out in doing a handful of like web dev things around New York, and then got into basically just like screwing around with APIs in kind of like the web 2.0 kind of timing, and was like, look, just fake it till you make it. You did this one thing, just write that down on your resume, and now you've got API experience, and just build on these things. So, you know, talking about the two-player games, just keep building it. Like, I'm not the end-all be-all of two-player games, but I have a lot of thoughts, I have a lot to say, and I'm doing that. So I can make progress. And now she's director of engineering at GitHub. So make a difference. And we are more or less done. Four people are super late to this panel. Either way, I'm going to get off the stage because it's been about an hour. So thank you all for showing up, even for 5 seconds. And I'm around.
Thank you.
P.S. Total expert on two players.
Just a reminder that everything you see here on Gamers on Games is made possible by patrons like you. Why not check out our Patreon page? It would really help us out.